The broadcast ministry of Christ Way Fellowship brings you victory for today. Exalting the Savior, evangelizing the seeker, and equipping the saint. Committed to the principle that you can have victory today and every day through Jesus Christ. Jesus said, "I have come that you might have life and have it more abundantly." And now here's your host, Pastor Wayne Duncan.
Well, thank you, Jim Stewart, for that introduction, and welcome to Victory for Today. Thank you for tuning in. We're studying again today in the book of Ruth. And so if you have a copy of the Word of God nearby, would you open it please to Ruth chapter 1. Now, Ruth is that little four-chapter book that's in between Judges and 1 Samuel. So it's an Old Testament book. Not easy to find, but I'm sure you can find it with those two landmarks for you to look for. And we're in chapter 2. Now, as we begin today, we're in a place in this wonderful story, this history, historical event, historical story, not just a story, but that is true in actual history, of a family that had moved away from Bethlehem. They had moved to Moab, and now Naomi is back in Bethlehem. Now, she didn't just go over to Moab and find it didn't suit her. Some people left New Orleans, had to leave New Orleans because of Katrina, and they went different places, and they might have gone to major cities or something, and they got there and they found out, well, this just doesn't fit. This don't fit. Houston don't fit. Dallas don't fit. Monroe, Jackson, they just don't fit. I want to go back. Well, you know what? She didn't come back because Moab didn't fit. She came back because it was really the thing she needed to do. She went over there, as she said, "I went over full and I came back empty." Now, she had a full house, if nothing else. She had a husband by the name of Elimelech, and she had two sons. They get over there to Moab, probably no more than 50 to 100 miles away from where they were in Bethlehem, but looking for good times. They went looking for a gold mine on the ground, someone has said, but what they found was a graveyard. And I say that because her husband died after they got over there, and then about 10 years later, her two sons died. And so Naomi now is back in Bethlehem without her husband, without her man, without her two sons, but she has someone with her, and that is Ruth. And Ruth is a Moabite that one of her sons had married while they were in Moab. And she's come back with Naomi. And last week we looked at that wonderful statement of commitment that Ruth made, not just to Naomi, but also to God, to the one true God. She turned her back on her family, on her religion, on her country, and has come back to Bethlehem in Judah, in the land of Israel, with Naomi. But she's come not just as someone just hanging on or someone to help, but she's come on as a new believer, someone who has put their faith and trust in God. And as we take up the story now, in verse 1, let's look at this. It says, "And Naomi and a kinsman of her husband, a man of great wealth of the family of Elimelech, whose name was Boaz. And Ruth the Moabitess said to Naomi, 'Please let me go to the field and glean among the ears of grain after one whose sight I may find favor.' And she said to her, 'Go, my daughter.' So she departed and went and gleaned in the field after the reapers, and she happened to come to the portion of the field belonging to Boaz, who was the family of Elimelech." I want to just stop and look at this with you now. If I were to try to give a title to this little talk today, it might be something like "Under the Spout, Where God's Grace Comes Out," because we're going to see now a tremendous turnaround beginning in the life of Naomi and especially of Ruth. Something wonderful is beginning right here at the first part of chapter 2. And as they come back, it's time for the barley harvest. You remember last week we said when they got back, that was when the barley harvest was starting, and we said, man, it's good to be where the blessing is. And so they're back where the blessing is. God has begun to bless His people again, which means the children of Israel have begun to follow after the ways of God again. They're no longer under that curse that comes when they got away from God's ways and God's laws and God's customs, but now they're back and they're living in the good graces of God, and His favor has returned to Israel, and they're enjoying that here in Bethlehem as this barley harvest comes in. Now we begin reading here, we come across the name Boaz. It's the first time we find that name, but this is a very important part of this whole story of Ruth and of Naomi and even the lineage of King David and the Lord Jesus Christ Himself. You'll find Boaz mentioned as one of the ancestors that lead right on down to the Lord Jesus Christ. If you look over there in the book of Matthew chapter 1, or if you go over to Luke and you look at those genealogies, you'll find the name Boaz. Now Boaz, it says, he was a man of great wealth. Now, other things that we know about him, he's called a man of great value. His name means to stand strong. He's a strong man. As a matter of fact, a generation or two, several generations later, I should say, when Solomon built his temple to the Lord, he put two great pillars outside that temple, bronze pillars, and one of them was named Boaz. So this man is very, very prominent. And it says that he was wealthy, he was well-to-do. Now, you know, you stop and think about it, here's a community that's kind of just, we could put it this way, just coming out of recession. And yet Boaz is already established. He's already established as a wealthy man, a man of power. He's a man that's well acquainted with the laws of God. He didn't have a team of lawyers working for him. He knew the Lord's commandments. He knew the laws in his own heart. He's a godly man. We're going to see that a little bit later on. And so it's a tremendous thing that when Naomi and Ruth come back to Bethlehem, that the connection is made here with Boaz. And this is this whole chapter is about how Boaz and Ruth meet and what takes place in that meeting and so forth. I think you're going to enjoy this. When Naomi came back, she was a broken woman. She had really, as we used to say in the Marine Corps, she had had the course. She had had the course. And so she's back now, a broken woman, a widow. Her husband's gone, her man's gone, her sons are gone. And there she is with this daughter-in-law who's really considered to be an outcast in Israel because she's from Moab. And so here she is. She had to have the sense that, you know, my life is really basically over, that nothing good is ever going to come my way again. And I wonder if there are those that, you know, are listening right now to Victory for Today, and you've kind of got that same attitude. You've been through so many things. So many things have just sort of blown up in your face. So many things have just failed, perhaps. We just go ahead and say that have fallen down around you. You tried to build something. Maybe you were involved in ministry and it all just crumbled. And now you're sitting there and you're thinking, I just don't think there's any hope for me anymore. I've lost so much and for so long, I'm not sure I'll ever win again. But let me say this to you in an encouragement. Dear friend, listen, God is still on His throne. Now last week, and I pointed out just in my conversation with you already in this talk, I said that Naomi had lost her man. But you know what? She hadn't lost her God. And God says that He is a father to the fatherless and that He is a husband to the widow. And so she's going to find out. Yes, she doesn't have her man anymore. Elimelech's gone. But she's got God, and He's still on her side whether she realizes it or not. And so we see God and His wonderful plan begin to unfold here for Ruth and for Naomi. And what we see here as we move on into verse 2 is is this is something refers back to God's welfare system. And Ruth asks Naomi, let me go and glean in the fields and follow after the reapers. Now, what's that all about? Well, there was a custom that was set up by God that when a person owned a piece of land and the harvest came in and it came time to harvest that crop, that they were just to kind of give it a one pass and they were to leave the corners of that field uncut so that the poor among them, so that people like Naomi and Ruth, the widows and those without any sort of support, that they could come along behind those reapers and there would be enough grain left that they could come behind them and pick up what was left, and that would be a way that they could be sustained. We're going to see how effective that was in just a moment. Now, this was God's welfare system. It's much better than what we have going on today. People went out and they gleaned for themselves, but there was something to glean out there. Sometimes people get in a bad situation, they keep butting their heads against a brick wall, it seems they can't get anywhere, and they just lapse back, and for at least a temporary time they get on the welfare roll, and then things get better and then come off of that. But this is the way God took care of His people. Leave something for the poor. And dear ones, we need to think about the poor too. Now you may say, well, I'm a tither. I tithe at my church. Well, yeah, but what about alms? You know, the Bible doesn't just speak about tithing. It speaks about alms. That's what we give to help people that are kind of down on everything, that are having a tough time. And so we need to look at that as well as our tithe to our church. And so here Ruth is, and she's asking to go out and follow after this custom. Apparently she's heard about this through Naomi, that this is the way that the poor are cared for in the land of Israel. And so she goes out. Now this is so tremendous. I hope that this charges you up the way it does me. But as we read on in verse 2, it says that she happened to come. As a matter of fact, literally she chanced upon to the portion of the field that belonged to Boaz. Now you know what? That's Scripture putting this in the terms of human perspective. But you know what? There was no chance about this. There was no happened to about this. This was something that God had ordained in His providence. I'm going to turn over here for just a second to Proverbs chapter 16, verse 9. The mind of man plans his way, but the Lord directs his steps. The Lord directs his steps. You see, this wasn't fate. This wasn't fate that brought Ruth to the field of Boaz. This wasn't chance. This wasn't a lucky break. This was the providence of God. There's no coincidence here. She was directed. She didn't hear a voice from God, but God guided her steps, and that's where she ended up, was the field of Boaz. And so she comes there in order to glean. Now, provision. We talk about the provision of God. Provision, providio, seeing before. God sees before. He provides for us by Him seeing before and putting in front of us the things that we need. You know, Jesus said to His disciples in one place, He said, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. I go to prepare a place for you. Now, dear ones, just think about that. I don't know what your circumstance is today. Maybe you're on shaky ground. Maybe your job is in jeopardy. Maybe you've lost your job. Maybe things are hard for you right now. But let me say on the authority of God's Word that God is providing for you. He will provide. Jesus is preparing for you. And so don't lose heart. Don't forget that God is in control. He's the one that said, I'll never leave you or forsake you. It's not a matter of fate or luck or coincidence. God guides our steps. There's a scripture that you hear people quote a lot. I'm going to just flip over there real quick. This is Romans 8:28. This is what it says, "And we know that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to His purpose, for whom He foreknew, He also predestined to become conformed to the image of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brethren." Now let's just think about that for a moment. It doesn't say that all things are good. It doesn't say that, because all things are not good. Sometimes things happen in our lives that are really bad. They're heartbreaking. We're rejected by people that we love. We're hurt in an accident, or disease comes into our bodies. Sometimes things come that are bad. We lose a loved one. Someone's taken in death, and it hurts. But you know what? The Bible promises us, God promises us right there, that He'll work all things together for our good, that all things are being worked together for our good, that we may be conformed to the image of Christ. Friends, listen, all this white stuff you see, this gray hair I'm talking about on me. Look, I've been down the road a piece, and I know about what hard times can be like, about what difficulties and struggles and joblessness and rejection. I know about these kind of things. I've walked that path myself. But you know what? God has never, never, never let us down. Never has let us down. It hasn't been exactly the way we wanted it. It wasn't the timing that we would like to see, but God's timing is the correct timing. And the way He leads our steps, He leads us aright. Don't give up on God. And so she ends up at the field of Boaz. Now in verse 5, well, let me move back up to verse 4. "Now behold, Boaz came from Bethlehem and said to the reapers," now get this, "May the Lord be with you. And they said to him, May the Lord bless you." Now, I tell you what, I've had a lot of different jobs. I mean, from 7 years in the Marine Corps through sales and all kinds of things that I've been involved in. I worked for the post office when I was going through Bible school, and I've had all kinds of jobs. I never had a boss show up and say, "May the Lord be with you." And if they had, I don't know if my fellow workers and I would have had the good sense to say back to him, "May the Lord bless you, boss." But this is the kind of man that Boaz is. Boaz is a strong man, a man of wealth and power, a man that knows God's ways and follows God's ways. He's a godly man. He's a good man. And he greets his workers like that. "May the Lord be with you." And they say back, "May the Lord bless you, boss." That's great. And look at verse 5 now. "Then Boaz says to his servants, Who is in charge of the reapers? Who is this young woman? Who is this young woman?" He sees Ruth out there gleaning in the field. Said, "Who is that?" She caught his eye. She caught his eye. Now, you know what? A lot of people have interpreted this in a lot of different ways. And you know, you can see how they might understand this. And we know, I'll just slip you a little hint if you don't already know. Boaz and Ruth end up getting married. But when Boaz comes out to that field that day, you know, he's not going through a midlife crisis. He's not looking for romance. He's just coming out to check on his workers. Ruth catches his eye. Ruth catches his eye. He says, "Who is that?" Now, why did he ask about her? Well, I believe that Ruth was a beautiful person. I believe that she had a beautiful countenance, but I don't really think that it was her beauty that attracted him necessarily. Maybe he noticed that. Surely if he looked at her and saw her, he did notice it. But what attracted her probably was the fact that she was dressed differently. She was somebody he didn't know also. So he inquires about, "Who is this?" She's from Moab, so very much, people in different clans and people in different countries dressed a little differently, just like it is today. And so perhaps she was wearing some garment that she brought from Moab with her. He wasn't going through the midlife crisis. He wasn't looking for a girlfriend when he showed up out there. I got to preach for a church up in Bastrop last week, and my wife went with me. And so as I began the message, I introduced my wife, and I said, "This is my wife." And the congregation said, "Amen." And I said, "You know what? That's what I said the first time I saw her. Amen." I don't think I said amen, but I probably said wow, something like that. Well, Boaz sees Ruth, and he asks about her. And the servants respond, and they say this back to him: "She is the young Moabite woman who returned with Naomi from the land of Moab. And she said, 'Please let me glean and gather after the reapers among the sheaves.' Thus she came and has remained from the morning until now. She has been sitting in the house for a little while." That is, they had a little pavilion there, perhaps a tent where they could take a break. But except for that break, she worked hard all day long. And Boaz speaks to Ruth, and this is what he says: "Listen carefully, my daughter. Do not go to glean in another field. Furthermore, do not go on from this one, but stay here with my maids. Let your eyes be on the field which they reap and go after them. Indeed, I have commanded the servants not to touch you. When you are thirsty, go to the water jars and drink from what the servants draw." And then then Ruth fell on her face, bowing to the ground, and said to him, "Why have I found favor?" King James here says grace. "Why have I found grace in your sight that you should take notice of me? For I am a foreigner." Now we begin to see here God is working in Boaz's heart. And this grace that she speaks about, this grace is beginning to show forth that he has toward her. Now, Boaz is a type of Christ. He's a type of Christ. And we'll point that out again and again as we go on through this book of Ruth. And he's a type of Christ. And so this grace that is coming from Boaz, it's kind of a picture of the grace of God that comes to us through Christ. This grace, and this, it's first expressed here in the grace of provision and the grace of protection. And he says to her, "Look, you stay here in my fields. You glean with my folks. I've told my workers to leave you alone," because you know there a woman was vulnerable when she was alone in that day. And so the grace of God is being poured out, just like it's poured out on us. And so as time goes by, as the day goes on, he invites her to come over and have lunch with his group. And so she comes over and she eats with them. And he answers her as to why he has shown her this favor. It's because of the way she has treated Naomi. And so he gives her a clue to that. He said, "It's all been fully reported to me." See, this was kind of the buzz, I guess, of Bethlehem, was that Naomi had come back and that she had this Moabite woman, her daughter-in-law, with her, and how she was caring for her and how they were working together. And he sees in Ruth that she's a woman of faith and a woman of character. She's not well-born. I believe she was physically beautiful. But you know what? There's a beauty that goes beyond the physical. And he sees a beauty in her character. He sees a beauty in her faith. And so that grace comes forward. And the next time we see this grace coming out is the satisfaction of grace. She gets up from this meal and she's satisfied. And the grace of God satisfies us, dear friend. Listen, we don't need anything outside. We've got the grace of God being poured out on us. It's kind of like going to Grandma's for Thanksgiving dinner and saying, "Well, I can't wait to get out of here and go through the drive-thru at Mickey D's on the way home." You don't care about going to McDonald's after going to Grandma's for Thanksgiving. And when we're wallowing in the grace of God, what has this world got for us? Well, she has a wonderful day. She goes back to Naomi And she's got enough food that she has gleaned. She's got enough food that would last them for 10 days. Now, as we go through this, we're going to see that she got there right at the beginning of barley harvest, and she stays with Boaz's group, right on through barley and wheat harvest. That's about 6 weeks. And if you get your calculator out and you figure it out, she was able to glean enough food for the two of them, for Naomi and herself, to last them for a whole year. Matter of fact, the thing comes out to about 360 days worth of food. She comes away from that, working 6 days a week, taking off for the Sabbath, of course. And so when she gets back home, Naomi says, "Whose field were you in?" And she tells her it was Boaz. And you know what? The light starts to come back on again for Naomi, because she knows that Boaz is not just someone they're related to, but he's in line as their kinsman redeemer, their Goel. And when we think about how he's a picture of Christ, we realize Christ became flesh that he might be our kinsman redeemer, that he might be like us. Jesus became like us in order that we, by his grace, through faith, might become like him. And so Boaz is a picture. You know, she goes home and she shares with Naomi all the goodies that she picked up out there. She had a take-home box, as a matter of fact, from her meal, and then all this huge amount of grain that she was, barley that she was able to glean that day. And there's all kinds of different estimates about how much she had, but it was at least enough for 10 full days. And so she shares this. You know, dear ones, we need to share the grace of God. We need to share the grace of God. We you know what? We need to be like the UPS man. You know, the UPS man goes down, he fills his truck up. He doesn't just drive that truck home and unload there. No, he goes all over unloading those packages, all over his route. And that's kind of a picture, in a way, of what it's like for us. When we get loaded down with the grace of God, we need to share that grace of God wherever we go. And so that's what she did. She shared that grace that she enjoyed with Naomi. And Naomi is certainly impressed about how much grain she was able to get in that one day's work. Naomi had lost her man, she'd lost her boys, but now she begins to see God's still on his throne, and he's still got a plan for her life. Now, dear friend, I just want you to realize that too, that, you know, you may have lost a lot, but God is still on his throne, and God loves you, and he has a wonderful plan for your life. It may not be according to your timing. It may not be the way exactly you want things to go, but God will guide your steps, and he will fulfill his plan for you. So trust God to do that. He is going to see you through. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not to your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. Well, our time is up. This is Wayne Duncan saying, the good Lord willing and the saints don't rise. I'll see you next time on Victory for Today.